Sri Lars?
Yes, sir.
You would like to say something before we begin? Or?
Yes, sir. I will.
No, please, go ahead.
Good afternoon, all. On behalf of Essence Forum, I invite you all today for today's ESF talk, which will be delivered by our director on the topic quaternary volcanism in India. Starting today, we are organizing weekly ESF talks on all Fridays, both from researchers from our institute and also external experts on different areas of earth science and related disciplines. So these talks has been arranged for the benefit of young researchers, PhD students, and young scientists. So I request you all to take this opportunity very well and make you best use of it. There are discussions after the talk, so you can involve in the discussion. You can post some questions, or if you have some clarifications, you can post it to the speaker. I also request you to keep your mics in mute, so that there is no background noise and the talks goes on smoothly. So today, our director will deliver the talk. This is the first talk in this new year. There's a brief period where we couldn't arrange the ESF talks, mainly because of the COVID situation. There are a few talks which has been arranged in virtual mode. So starting in this week, this is 8th January 2021, we will have ESF talk regularly, as I said earlier, on a weekly basis. So now I request our director to deliver the talk.
Thank you, Sri Lars. Happy New Year to everybody. And I really like that these people have put in a lot of effort to restart again this forum. So I encourage everybody to participate actively, give seminars and share your results or any new ideas you get, so that it remains active for a very long time. And this would be a good forum to discuss each other's work and have some positive feedback from people. So in the series, I said, okay, maybe I should begin because you have to lead by example. So the first seminar, it will be on quaternary volcanism in India. So this is some work I have done and still doing, so which I'd like to share with you. So you can interrupt me in between if it becomes too monotonous, and I'd be happy to answer your queries. So let me see if I can finish it on time. Though there are a lot of slides, pictures and all that. So you can interrupt me. Even though he said sometimes mics, there are a lot of echo, but you still can ask me questions in between. So I will now share my slide and let us get into business. It's not visible, is it?
Not accessible.
Present now a window. Okay. Is it visible?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay. All right. So here I'm talking about the time period of last few million years. So probably for most of us are geologists, I guess, but there are chemists and physicists. So quaternary is the most recent period in Earth's history. We are living in it right now. So during this period, whatever volcanism happened in India, this is what I'm going to discuss with you. So unfortunately, we don't have many volcanoes like many other countries in the world. So all our, active volcanoes. So the volcanic activity in the recent past have been mostly confining to Andaman and Nicobar Islands. And many of these volcanic activity are actually submarine. It is below the ocean bottom, sea surface. but some of them are sub-aerial, like these two pictures I have shown here. The left side, it is called Narkondam, and the right one is Barren Island. So before I get into these details and the work we have been doing, I would like to tell more about volcanoes and why we should study them, and what interesting things they can reveal. So this is what I will share, and then I'll get into my work mostly, or our work. All right. So why should we study volcanoes? I suppose you know what are the volcanoes. But by definition, they are basically openings on a planet's surface where molten rock and ash gases escape from deep interior. So volcanoes basically tell us that a particular planet is active internally or not, which means we have a lot of heat to escape. So the only way it can escape is through volcanic activity. So a planet's, any planet or terrestrial planets we have, whether we want to know whether it is an active planet, volcanoes are the features from which we can judge whether the activity is there inside or not. So there are a couple of pictures I wanted to show. One is an island in North Pacific, Aleutian Islands, and the next one is Hawaiian volcano. So it is Kilauea. So currently Kilauea is active, and so this is a picture of recent times. Okay, so where are these volcanoes are mostly located? And this is a textbook material. We call it Ring of Fire. These volcanoes are mostly located along these particular zones, not everywhere on Earth's surface. And interestingly, this zone are actually plate boundaries. If geologists know what are plates, but for others, probably nowadays everybody knows in schools they are taught. So plates are the places where we have, the surface of the Earth is actually moving. So we have lithospheric plates, and they are moved past each other. Somewhere they converge, somewhere they diverge, and sometimes they have transformed. Faults are there along across that they basically shear. So along most of these boundaries, you would like to see some kind of volcanic activity, particularly along subduction zones or convergent boundaries. Most volcanoes are located. So these are the convergent boundaries along which we have most number of earthquakes as well as most number of volcanoes. However, there are volcanoes within the plates. For example, Hawaiian volcanoes, they are actually occurring within the plate. And of course, there are submarine volcanoes along plate boundaries called mid-oceanic ridges. So where the divergence is taking place, so the material from below comes up and it erupts on the surface as volcanoes. So this is where most volcanoes are located. And of course, if you look at Indian territory, we have volcanoes here, and it is a part of this Indonesian chain of volcanoes. So we have only one active volcano and one dormant or extinct volcano in the Andamans of recent times. So why should one study volcanoes? Okay, I always say that there are many surface features one should study because simply they are beautiful. We would like to know how they form, how did they come into existence in the first place. So they are spectacular landforms. So you would like to study how these landforms form. And of course, there are sources of mineral deposits. Just an example, I showed a sulfur deposit in Indonesia. But there are many deposits which are actually formed because of volcanic activity. And of course, they do pose they are natural hazards. This is one famous example of Pompeii, where Vesuvius eruption wiped out an entire city. So we still see people buried like this in the debris or ash fall or pyroclastic flow. So therefore, volcanoes should be studied because you want to know whether there is imminent threat to life and property. And most importantly, for geologists or for our scientists, we study volcanoes where they are record keepers of our planetary evolution. So as I told you, whether a planet is active and how long it has been active, what happens during this evolution, you want to understand, then you have to study volcanic material. So the volcanoes are the record keepers of any planet's evolution, particularly the terrestrial planets. Okay, and so I just listed what exactly our scientists or geologists, why they study volcanoes. We want to understand the deep earth processes, okay, and we understand the chemical evolution of the mantle. So the chemistry of any planet, particularly the terrestrial planets, start with a particular composition, but over a period of its evolution, it changes. So you want to trace this change. You want to understand how the chemistry of this whole thing changes, how differentiation takes place, how the mantle changes, how the core changes. So since we don't have any direct access to the interior of Earth, so we have to rely on things that come out of this interior. So they come out only through these volcanoes, through volcanic material or magmas, what you call them. So they basically are windows to the deep mantle. So this is what I have been trying to study for the last several years. Right from the beginning of my PhD, I've been studying various type of magmatic rocks or mantle-derived rocks, which can tell us about how the Earth's mantle has evolved through time, particularly when its chemistry is concerned. So chemically, continuously it is evolving. So we want to track this evolution right from, let's say, birth of the planet. So you have to study volcanic rocks through time and understand their chemical evolution. That will give you an idea about how the interior of the Earth has changed through time. So therefore, they serve as windows to Earth's mantle. All right, so where is mantle located? So we have a crust which is thin, basically. It is a rigid crust, 0 to 33 kilometers, depending on where you're looking at. Oceanic crusts are thinner than the continental crust. And then, of course, we have a mantle that goes on to 2,900 kilometers deep. So it is mostly solid. And then we have a core. Of course, we all know this. A core, outer core is liquid, inner core is solid. And the core is crystallizing, therefore it is producing a lot of latent heat. So that latent heat tried to escape through the planet interior. However, since mantle is silicate and rocky, they are very bad conductors of heat. The heat doesn't dissipate that easily through conduction. So the only way heat can escape is through convection. And this convection leads to melting. And because of melting, we have volcanoes on the surface. All right, so how does actually melting take place? So there are three ways rocks can melt, or silicate rocks can melt. One is directly heat it. If it reaches its temperature of melting, it will melt. Or in the Earth, actually, we have what is known as decompression melting, where Earth interior, particularly the mantle, is solid, even though the temperatures are high enough to melt the minerals, but it doesn't melt. This is because the pressures are so high, the melting temperature goes up, or the solidus temperature goes up. So even though the ambient temperature is high enough, it doesn't melt because its melting temperature has gone up in that pressure. So if you decompress it, you release the pressure, it will melt in the ambient temperature. This I will explain in a figure. So, and then of course, addition of water or CO2. Fluids also can change the melting temperature of silicate material or rocks. So any of these three, heating or decompression or addition of water, can lead to melting of mantle. So if I want to give in a small cartoon, this is probably for geologists is a familiar picture, but for others, it's just a simple phase diagram where in y-axis we have pressure, in x-axis we have temperature. So this is how mantle looks like. So the geotherm is the ambient temperature. So if you are at 10 gigapascal pressure, the temperature is here. And this is called solidus and liquidus, which is basically joins the melting temperature of the material. So let's say beyond the solidus, things start melting. So which means to say the temperature, ambient temperature here, the rocks are at this temperature, but it needs this kind of heat or increase in temperature in order to start melting. So how that can happen? it can happen if you increase the temperature somehow. So that can happen inside the Earth's interior. If some high temperature material from below comes up, it hits the top, then you can have melting. So if it reaches here, it will melt. Or you do, you package up a mantle which is located here. If it goes up, it touches the solidus, it will start melting. So this is upwelling, or you can call it decompression. The decompression melting happens like this. Or you can have addition of water. So what happens? This is dry solidus liquidus. This is what I showed you. But if water is added to the mantle by any means, water or CO2, the solidus temperature decreases. Same with the liquidus. Liquidus is above which everything is liquid. So by adding water, you can actually decompress this melting temperature so that in the ambient temperature, it will melt. So this is how mantle melts. So we are interested in the last one because most of the mantle actually melts through decompression. But in areas like subduction zones where a lot of water is put into the mantle, this kind of melting happens. I'll show you that. So melting happens only at certain places, not everywhere in the mantle, and it is always partial because the whole mantle never melts. It cannot melt. So the melting happens in various pockets, and that's why you have volcanoes distributed only in certain pockets, not everywhere. Where do they form? So if you look at a cartoon like this with all plate tectonic features there, so these are called subduction zones where the lithospheric plates goes down. So the surface area of the earth is maintained. So therefore, when the new crust forms along mid-oceanic ridges, here mantle upwells, melts, and new crust is formed. So therefore, this whole thing starts moving in either direction to accommodate that new crust. So the older crust naturally will go down. So this cycle is roughly, on the surface, it is roughly 200 million years. That means you will never get oceanic crust, which is older than 200 million years, even though our Earth is 4.6 billion year old. So the newer crust forms, the older crust goes down back into the mantle. So because of that, you have this water going into the mantle and melting happens. So here, they are intraplate volcanoes. These are very special volcanoes, which happens only in certain places because there is the lower mantle upwells onto the surface. And then there is a decompression melting. So here also there is decompression, but it is within the plate boundary or on the plate boundary. So there are, these are the various places where we always see volcanoes or volcanic activity in a plate tectonics model. So where are these places? There are subduction zones. These are the places where volcanic activity takes place. There are hot spots which are within the plate. And there are mid-oceanic ridges. It is again the new crust which forms. And then, of course, we have continental rift zone. Again, this is within the plate. So there are within plate volcanoes and there are plate boundary volcanoes. Plate boundary volcanoes are more common than within the plate volcanoes. All right. So why we should actually be interested in studying volcanoes in order to understand the evolution of the mantle? So over the years, for last 70 years or so, people have studied all volcanoes or volcanic materials, and that too with time, because older volcanic material may be preserved on the surface because they get abducted, or there may be older volcanoes, older ocean floors preserved on continents as ophiolites. One can study them. So people have studied various volcanic activity going back in time to Archean, or even sometimes you may if you are lucky, you get Hydean information also. It's the oldest time period in Earth's history. Studying all these, so there are many ways one can study. People study the geochemistry and they also study isotopic compositions. So it has been seen that if you study certain isotopic composition, you may be able to understand how the Earth's interior or mantle has evolved through time. So people study strontium isotope, lead isotopes, and neodymium isotopes. So these are three radiogenic isotope ratios of rubidium, strontium decay. This is uranium lead, thorium lead decay. This is samarium, neodymium decay. So what I mean to say, different pockets of mantle or different places in the mantle who have typical composition of these isotopic compositions. And these isotopes, let's say we started with uniform composition of all three. However, with time, this has changed. This is what we observe. So this is a study review. Of course, it is quite old now, 92. Things have changed after that. However, I like this picture, so I have put it here. So you have to understand this. So far, we have observed four different mantle components. When you take these three isotopes, people have observed that we have enriched mantle 1 and 2, high mu mantle is a particular mantle where uranium to lead ratio is very high, or depleted mantle. These are depleted in lighter rare earths. So these four mantle components have been observed. That means we have packets of mantle inside the earth which have these four different type of isotopic compositions. So by studying many ocean island basalts, that means lower mantle derived rocks, upper mantle derived rocks, people have found that indeed the earth's composition probably started from this, it is called FOJO, focus zone. So they saw, if you study all these rocks, they actually tend to focus to a unique composition. So probably earth's mantle started somewhere here, and then over a period of time, they have gone out in different directions. So why did this happen? Obviously, the uniformity or the homogeneity has been disturbed over a period of 4 billion years. So how did this happen? So what we understand today, that this heterogeneity, what we observe, is basically through what is known as subduction zone processes. So let's see what is this. So heterogeneities are introduced from the top as well as from bottom. From core also it can get introduced, but most of it is introduced through subduction zone. So this is a cartoon where a plate subduction is being shown. A plate is subducting beneath another plate. Okay. So what happens? A new oceanic crust forms here. So the mantle material comes here, upwells, melts, and new crust forms. It takes about 100 to 200 million years when it goes down back into the mantle. So during the stay on the surface of the earth, the composition of these rocks change. Even though when they erupt, they are very similar to the composition of their source, which is the mantle. The 200 million year time scale during which it interacts with surface processes or the water, air, etc., lot of alteration happens. Not only that, lot of continental material can come in and get deposited. So the entire thing, when it gets subducts, it introduces heterogeneity back into the mantle. So why should there be heterogeneity if everything has formed from the mantle? The thing is, isotope decay happens because during this melting process, a lot of elements get partitioned into different material. Let's say, if you look at rare earth elements, for example, when melting happens, most of the lighter rare earths are preferred in the melt. So they are extracted out of the melt, leaving the mantle depleted in this. So from here, from focus zone, they will travel towards depleted mantle. However, when they come to the surface and the crustal material which are here, when they contribute and they go back into the mantle, they tend to pull this thing up back again and even beyond what it is from the focus zone. Why? Because over a period of 200 to 400 million years, even the continents are much older, they generate a lot of radiogenic isotopes. Because if you look at this isotopic composition I showed you earlier, strontium 87 is produced by rubidium 87, lead is produced by uranium, 133 neodymium produces samarium decay. So decay happens and you produce more of it. So the mantle doesn't have their parents, whereas the crust has because of this partitioning. So over 200 million years, you enrich them and they pull this back to a very high or enriched mantle. So this heterogeneity introduces this enrichment back in the mantle. So this is the understanding over the last 40, 50 years. This is what we have understood. But we are still trying to understand how this heterogeneity actually is introduced into the mantle. So there are many components in a recycled lithosphere. There are crust material, there are mantle material, there are continental sediments, there are oceanic sediments. Which one is contributing to what? It's still not clear. So what is that? My motivation has been over last 20-25 years is that I've been trying to understand how does this coastal recycling affect the chemistry of the mantle. Like I told you, which component is actually contributing what? So how can one study this? So we have to rely on this particular type of magmatism, which is subduction zone magmatism. That means we want to know exactly how this heterogeneity is introduced. So you have to study the magma which are coming out of this place. So this is what I have been trying. So if I want to study these rocks in India and in recent times, so where else I can go? I have to go to Andamans, because the current subduction zone, this is a Google map, so you can see this. So this is the subduction zone, and Andaman Islands, since it belongs to India, so you have an access to this island, and fortunately it has some volcanoes which can give us some insight into the subduction zone processes. So this is what led us to start a project in this region. So how exactly it looks like? So these are the main islands of the Andamans. These are not volcanic islands, even though we have some ophiolites here, but they are mostly sedimentary rocks which have been deposited at the subduction zone. So this is an accretionary prism. So this is the trench where the Indian plate is subducting beneath what is known as Burma plate. Okay. And the plate motion is roughly 4 to 5 centimeters per year. So this is the accretionary waves which has come out of this thing and to give us these islands, Savarial Island. So this is the island arc. I'll explain where do they occur. So island arcs are basically volcanoes. So you see these tiny dots here. So they are the two active subaerial volcanoes. Not active. One is active, the other one is extinct. So they are subaerial island arc, because they are island and they are called arc in plate tectonics terms. That's Barren Island, that's Narcon Dam. And then there is a oceanic ridge which is spreading this Andaman Sea. So Andaman Sea is opening. So these things are very new. I'll tell you how old they are. So a new ocean crust is being formed here, tearing apart this crust here, the oceanic crust. So this is how it looks. Okay. So one can also know from geophysics. Geophysicists are here. They will know very well. You can actually find out how does the subduction profile look like. So here, basically what you do, this is a Benioff zone, and geologists will also know, I guess. So earthquakes occur because a solid is trying to go inside another solid. So there will be a fault. So because of that big fault line, we will have a lot of earthquakes. This is what Indonesia is famous for. So this subduction, so this is earthquake foci are plotted. And you just connect the dots, you will probably see the slab itself. We call it slab, which is called subduction plate. So this plate is subducting beneath another plate. So all these earthquakes occur because it is trying to push in into another mantle. The Andaman Islands are located here. And there are a lot of other earthquakes which basically tell us this zone is very active. So there are a lot of faults. And one can actually find out each one of them, but I'm not going to discuss all these. So this is how it looks from geophysical point of view. If I make a cartoon out of it, this is how it will look. So this is Indian plate so converging into Burmese plate. So this is the subduction zone. So the lithosphere is subducting beneath another lithosphere, which is called Burma plate or Burmese plate. And then there is a mid-oceanic ridge which separates Burmese plate from Eurasian plate. And these are accretionary prism. Whatever sediments were deposited in the Indian side, they got crushed into making these islands, where basically there are the thrust faults or reverse faults which push them up. So we have all these sediments plus part of the ocean crust which actually uplifted to make these islands, we call Andamans. And then we have this volcanic arc through which the material from inside is melting and coming up as volcanoes. And Barren Island is the active volcano in the Andaman Sea. So this is a rough picture which I just wanted to show how the subduction zone profile would look like from a layman point of view. All right, so what are the specific objectives? Yes, I told you my main aim, but when you go into a particular area, you should define your objectives, which will answer your main question. So first, since we went to study these volcanoes, very little was known except for work of GSI, which has contributed significantly, but mostly describing rocks, but very little about geochronology or geochemistry or any other isotope work. Nonetheless, we also wanted to know the volcanism and eruptive style of these volcanoes, how the volcanoes are, the extent of various lava flows. That means if volcanic activity takes place, how long it takes, how long does it last, and how many lava flows are there. There's a lot of different questions related to volcanic activity. Most importantly, the age of the volcano. When we started work, nothing was known how old these volcanoes are, which are subaerial, and there are underwater volcanoes also, and how many eruptions they had. There was no clue about it. And then the crust on which this volcano occurs, that how old it is, that was also not known, because we need to know in order to find out how much crust may have been contributed into the magma of the volcanoes. And of course, we have to study the geochemistry to understand the mantle. So you have to do a lot of isotope and other geochemical work in order to model the contribution of the subducting plate to the mantle. And therefore, you can model the overall contribution of various elements and material in a longer term time scale. So these were our specific objectives when you started the work. And of course, when you work in a volcano, you always like to know the degree of melting, where does the magma come from, the source and generation of magma, type of melting, a lot of similar things we try to answer through geochemical and isotopic tracers. Okay, so now I'll show you some pictures. So this is the Andaman Islands on a map, or the main Andaman Islands. Okay, Port Blair is here. These two volcanoes are located in the east. Barren Island is located here. And the other island, which is Narkondam, is an extinct volcano. I'll tell you why we think, some people initially thought it is dormant, but we think it is extinct. And so it is in the north, and it's much larger than Barren Island volcano. So how does one go there? So you have to go either from Port Blair, take a ship. Mostly we go by Coast Guard ship. Some people take a Navy ship also. It takes about 7 to 8 hours to reach Narkondam. Or you can even go from North Andaman called Diglipur. From here also you can go. So when you reach the island, so I'll first discuss a little bit about Narkondam, because our work is still ongoing on Narkondam. And so this is how it looks from the ship. So this was a picture taken in 2009. So Narkondam is an extinct volcano. It's about 700 meters high. I'll show you the details. It's a beautiful place. We landed there, first trip was in 2009. Fortunately, on that island, there is a police post, because this is a border for us, for Indian side, border between India and Burma. So therefore, they have made a permanent station, but it is mostly sheds. I mean, there is no barracks, actually, police barracks, where you can stay for some time. So from ship, you go on a boat, and it's a rocky beach. A very small beach is there. So from the ship, you have to go on a small boat, particularly this Gemini kind of thing, and then land on it and stay with them and do the field work. So it's an interesting place. Water is there, so absolutely no issue. One can do a lot of field work. So this is how it looks. This is a picture, of course, Google Earth picture. This is the island. And there are some pictures of the island when you go around the island, try to see how it looks and collect samples. Because inside the island, the slopes are very high, but we still try to do some field work, and densely forested. So what are the statistics of the island? The area is around 7.6 kilometer square. The central plug is 710 meters. So currently it's very difficult to understand what kind of volcano it was, but it is definitely a stratovolcano. I'll show you a picture of how stratovolcano looks like. But since it is thickly vegetated, it's very difficult to go to various places. Some people have gone, even GSI claims that they have gone to the top. I'm not very sure. We tried twice, failed. It's very difficult, really. And the water depth here is 2.5 kilometers. So some more pictures. So you can see these are mostly debris deposits. So we call it in volcanological terms, we call it lahar. So these ash and boulders get washed out. They are deposited. When they are erupted, they are deposited on the flanks of the volcano. And when there is rainfall, there will be mudslides and they will get deposited on the coast. So you will get this kind of features. So all along the islands, you will have these kind of features. Interestingly, this island where you see a lot of magma mixing, in the sense for geologists, it will be a common term. For others, I would like to say that when a magma comes up through a volcano, it remains in a magma chamber before it has sufficient pressure to erupt. So when it erupts, if it takes a very short time, it will actually catch a lot of older material along with it. There will not be enough time for mixing. So you will see older rocks being caught up in the newer melt. So when they crystallize, they look like this. So this is on a small scale, this is on a large scale. You see a lot of older things are caught up in the newer thing. So and this whole thing is a rock with all kinds of old rocks being embedded into it. So we call them xenoliths. So they are xenoliths of older material, older rocks. So this happens when you have the eruption is very quick. So which means this volcano had a very explosive past, and it's a very complex evolutionary history because a lot of magma mixing we can see. So I will not get into the details of magma mixing because there are two or three different types of magma can come and mix. And then you will have typically this kind of feature. That means in this one rock, you may have several generations of this kind of material, not just two. All right, so this is a picture just to show where we could access for sampling. So these are the sampling locations. And these red dots are the places where we have taken rocks for dating purpose. Okay, so some field photographs. So there are certain dikes, old dikes are there. And of course, you can get down and it's tricky, but one can sample these places. So we tried to find out the age of this volcano. There are many ways one can do, but you have to define what is the age you are looking for. So we basically wanted to see what was the last time this volcano erupted. Okay, and so therefore we tried to collect the youngest material found on the stratigraphically youngest material, and we dated it. It came out to be 0.55 million years, which is 550,000 years. And the oldest material, which is like this, which are mostly occur as xenoliths, is 3.5 million years. And then we also have 1.8 million year rocks. So this dating is done by argon method. This work is not published. It was just presented somewhere. It will soon be in print. So what do we understand from here? It means that volcano has been active at least from 3.5 million years ago until 550,000 years ago. At least during this period, this volcano was active. So which means there are more numbers which I am not showing. Several numbers suggest that the volcano, the last eruption of the volcano is 550,000 years old, which means most likely this is the time when the volcano became extinct. After that, there has been no activity. The oldest activity we have observed is 3.5 million years old. It could mean this is on the surface of the volcano. Now we have to understand there are 2.5 kilometers of the volcano below the sea. So the volcano is definitely older than 3.5 million years. How old? Beyond this, we don't know yet. Okay, So the volcano is just a cartoon to show you. These are stratovolcanoes. Arc volcanoes which occur on subduction zone are like this mostly. So they are stratified. That means you will have ash deposit on top of lava flows, then again lava flows, then again ash, like that. So they build up a stratigraphy like this. So that's why they are called stratovolcanoes. And of course, you have eruption of ash as well as lava. And there will be a magma chamber. So this is people from geophysical means, people try to understand where is the magma chamber. But that you can do in case of an active volcano. In a case of an extinct volcano, you have to rely on certain geochemical proxies. I'll touch upon that.
Jyoti, I have a small one clarification.
Yes, please, sir.
Yeah. So you said, you know, this volcano was a dormant. It was not, you know, active. When was it the last active? The precise age can be found out from that?
Yeah, that's what I told, you know. See, in what we read when, I mean, mostly from literature, people thought it is dormant. That means they didn't know the ages. I mean, mostly no ages were known.
Okay.
But when we dated the surface lava flows,
okay,
we have dated, I have shown one picture here.
Yeah, 550.
But we have many date numbers which from the surface lava flow. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The entire island is actually on the surface. It is made up of this age, rocks.
Okay.
0.55. So we have a suspicion that this could be the point where this became the last eruption.
Okay.
So 550,000 years ago, there may have been some ash deposits after that. But a major activity took place 550 million years.
Okay.
And not only that, there is some volcanic study also there, because when large scale activity takes place, the volcano blows up. Entire thing takes. All right.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
But this is what we know today. If somebody finds younger rocks, it will be interesting.
Yeah.
All right. So just to show you some rock pictures, because I will discuss more about Barren Island, but just to show you that here we see a lot of features which are basically tell us that this has a very explosive past and had a lot of old material is incorporated into the new lavas. And if you look at the chemistry, what we do, geochemists usually do classification of rocks. That also gives us an idea about how evolved a particular volcano is. So the rocks in this island, Narcondom, are andesites. So a direct mantle-derived rock from a normal mantle would be basaltic. This is called TAS diagram. You can classify igneous rocks based on silica content and sodium potassium content. So more primitive the rock is, it will have less silica. More advanced or more, what you say, evolved rock, it will have higher silica. So you have to understand like this, mantle has low silica, crust has high silica. So if something gets contaminated or evolves, or crystallizes, so silica gets remains in the younger males. So slowly, slowly the rock will get more silica rich. So this is a situation where silica is high. So high silica in Narcondom could mean these lavas have some kind of contribution from continental material. It is not purely oceanic material. Or it could also mean in the magma chamber, they had enough crystallization to cause this kind of enrichment of silica. But somehow we don't see that, because we see there are a lot of xenoliths are caught up. So we think it is more explosive. So more likely the chemistry is because of the crustal contamination. So well, I'll go into a little bit detail of that. So then you do various kind of studies, and this figure is busy. I don't want you to get too much into it. It's just to compare the Narcondom lavas with a lot of isotopic compositions have been measured. So what we see that the Narcondom lavas are more evolved. So these are Narcondom lavas. They are more evolved compared to Barren Island lavas. Evolved in the sense they have more silica, more strontium isotope or enriched strontium isotope ratio, less enriched neodymium, which kind of tells us that these are evolved magmas. Not only that, they have high slab contribution. The subducting material is basically silica rich. It also have higher strontium, lower neodymium compared to the mantle. So if they contribute, they like to pull down the magma. This is what has happened here, which I'll tell you another example. In lead isotope, if you see, these are narcondom, these are barren. So narcondom has higher 206 lead, which comes from higher uranium. Higher uranium comes from the crustal material. This is how we try to understand, which means narcondom has a significant contribution from the subducting plate compared to barren. I'll get into more detail later. So now I go to Barren Island because I'm short in time. So Barren Island is the only active volcano we have in the Indian subcontinent. So the first report of its activity dates back to 1787 when British ships noticed some volcanic activity. This is actually a sketch drawn by some naval officer of British India. And then the first time it was reported was 1595 AD when they saw this island. So it probably looked like this. That means we already have a cone spewing ash or something. And then there was this caldera. So in 1990, so GSI people started studying this in early 90s. And this is what they saw. In fact, there was a lighthouse here. And this is how it looked. This is a photograph in 1990. So Dr. Haldar from GSI studied quite a lot of these materials, but he's no longer there. He died sometime in 2002 or 3. So nonetheless, so this was how it looked in 91, but there was no activity then. Then in 91, suddenly they started observing this. This is a cinder cone. This is called cinder cone. From this, the eruption started. So this is the first Indian record from Indian scientists. The activity was recorded in 91 by GSI. So from the record and historical records, what we know that this volcano was active between 1787 to 1832, 91, 93, 94. So these are major eruptions, 2005, 2006, 2009, 2010. So we started working on this volcano from 2007. So since then, these are major activities. That means you have lava flows. So I'll show you some pictures, more pictures. 92, after the first eruption of 91, this is how it looked. It is a so small cinder cone. Cinder is, you know what is cinder. It's burnt rock ash. And so they make a cone from the center, eruption takes place. So 2003, this is how it looked. So there is a breach in the caldera wall. So you can see the picture 2005. So this is the caldera and this is the cone. Or inside the cone, you will have a crater. So from which this ash comes out. And the lava, you can see the lava is flowing into the sea through that breach in the caldera wall. So we didn't know when the caldera formed. When did this whole thing collapse to form the caldera? And then when did this breach happen in the caldera wall so that the lava can flow? So all these things are still unknown. We have attempted a little bit, but I'll tell you what we have known so far. But this is how it looks in 2005. So lava was coming and falling in the sea. So this is all GSI pictures mostly. So where is Barren Island? Barren Island is located here. It's about some 85 kilometers south of Narcondom. And of course, from Port Blair, you go there on ship. And when you arrive, this is how it looks today. This was 2017. So you go on Coast Guard ships. And from the ship, you get down on this small boat and then try to land on this. So what you see here is that breach on the caldera wall. And you see these lava flows. And that's the central cone. So this is how we go usually, and then you land, and there are small places where you can land, but if there is a high tide, these places may not be visible, and if you land on the rocky coast, things can be dangerous also. So there are a lot of hazards in working on Barren Island because it's an active volcano and ever growing, because there are very few landing sites. And where do you land to get in? There are a lot of difficulties. Even if you land in some places, it's very difficult to climb the wall because the slopes are almost 45 degrees or more. And there are a lot of ash and noxious gases, particularly sulfur dioxide always falls on, you can smell the sulfur several kilometers away also. And sometimes if you have high waves, boats can topple. So all your camera instruments can go bad. This has happened to us in 2007. And on the island, so these are very typical lava flows called lava flows. So volcanologists will tell you there are two types of lava flows. One is called ropi lava or pahoe hoe, and the other one is called lava. Is basically, it's rubbly kind of thing. So you see this. This is a lava flow, but you don't see any continuous feature. They are all broken into pieces. So this is how it looks. So if you want to work across this, this is extremely difficult. It takes like several hours to even walk 1 kilometer. Anyways, so this is what Barren Island looks from satellite Google Earth image. So these are the landing sites we have attempted earlier. Landing site one is the most common site where people land. Sorry, landing site three, I think. And then we have landed here. Some new lava flows we saw, so we landed. And there is a nice beach on this side, but its approach is very difficult. So these are the tracks which we have taken for our field studies. So you can see we have only touched only a few points. It's very difficult. We have gone up to this, but climbing this one is extremely difficult. But if young guys can do it, it's nice, but it is difficult to go on this side. Some GSI people did climb to the top of the crater, but that was before the eruption took place. So they are lucky, but once it goes down, maybe we should be attempting to go and see the crater here on the cinder cone. So that's the caldera, that's caldera rim. That's the cinder cone, which is the, and the inside we have the crater, and there's the lava delta. This is how we have named it. Anybody is free to name anything else. So this is 3.2 kilometer in diameter, and the caldera rim height is 320, and the cinder cone height is 240. So caldera is higher. So that tells us basically this whole thing has formed because of some kind of collapse, because this thing is higher than this one. So that means it could have been a much taller volcano. At some point, this whole thing collapsed. It happens when the magma chamber, actually magma dries up in the magma chamber, so the crust collapses. So that might have happened, but we have not still studied even after all these years. I am not sure how it happened, really. So water depth here is 2.3 kilometers. Okay, so this is a more closer look. So this is you land on this small beach here, enclosure, and then climb onto this lava flow. This is a close-up view, but from here to there, it is probably roughly a kilometer, or maybe 1.5 kilometers. Yes, so this is a more better picture. So we tried to map the lava flows, whatever was possible. So our team had volcanologists also, Hetu Sheth from IIT Bombay. So we did a lot of tracking and tried to map, but of course it is based on satellite images, older records, GSI records and all that. This could also be wrong. So, and freshness of the lava is identifiable because younger, older the lava flow, it will be covered with ash. So that is easy to locate. But nonetheless, it is not that easy, and this could change also. Okay, so this is what we know and tried to do. And I thought maybe I'm showing something. I would like to show a couple of videos. So this is 2009. It doesn't work, is it? Okay. So in 2009, we saw a lava flow like this. And this was active. This is taken from the ship. Okay, and then in 2010, we were much closer. We are collecting samples. So these kind of ash eruptions are quite frequent. In those days it was, but I don't know how it is now. This happens every 30, 40 minutes, you will have a large eruption. This one was very nice, so I thought I'd share it. That audio is the volcano sound, not wind. And so we collected ash, just catching onto with opening a polythene bag and collected some ash. So it depends on the wind direction. And in 2015, one trip where in the early morning, this is what we saw. So you have to be very lucky. Because other people may have better pictures. So this is what we had or we could capture. So this is falling. These are cinders. They're rubbles, basically, burnt rocks, you can say. So they make up this cone. So the cone forms because of this rolling boulders, bombs, or high temperature cinders. Okay, quickly. So what I showed you, the lava flows are there. However, suppose you want to know how many times this volcano has erupted in the past. It's very difficult to know unless you date every layer. But on the volcano, everything is covered with the newer activity. Recent activities cover all the old stuff. So to know exactly how the activity would have taken place, if there is a major eruption, I showed you ash eruption. The ash goes out from here and gets deposited around. So if we could get a core, sediment core, the sediment also gets deposited along with the ash. So you can date the sediments. So sediment can be dated by carbon-14 because surface oceans contain foraminifera. So they can be dated by carbon-14. So you indirectly will know the age of the ash. So this is what we attempted. So what we did, we collected cores, so several cores. One core was a nice core where we could get these ash beds. So this is what the picture shows. What happened to the present? Okay. So so this is a 4-meter core we collected 32 kilometers southeast of the Varan Island. So how did we identify the ash? Ash you can very easily identify because they're very different from normal ocean sediments or terrigenous sediments because you will have a lot of these rock fragments in it. So we had identified 7 ash layers. Now, how do I know whether they are from Barren or not? So we do what is known as chemical or isotopic fingerprinting. So this is what a lot of people in NIO used to do. So but we did isotope fingerprinting. What we did, if it is coming from Barren Island, then isotopically, if you measure strontium neodymium isotope, they should exactly match with that. So you can see the ash beds are these green colored ash layers, 7 layers. And this is the lava on the Barren Island. So exactly fall inside that. So this is not Toba. Toba is somewhere here. Narkondom is, these ones are Narkondom. So definitely they are not Narkondom ash. So they are ash from Barren Island. Now, what do they mean? It means if the ash layers has gone 32 kilometers away, that means this was a major eruption. So that way, if we could date these ash layers, you know the activity of the volcano. So this is what we did. So you cannot date the ash directly. So we dated the sediment layers or sediments. So here you can see these are the carbon-14 ages. This is a accelerator mass spectrometry carbon-14 ages. So based on that, you will have an age model. And from the age model, you can determine the ash layer ages. So these are the ash layer ages. 8 kiloyear, 12.3, 17.3, etc. Which means that there have been major eruptions are these intervals. So that means at 8 kiloyear, there was a major eruption. At 62 kiloyear, there was a major eruption. See, this is how you build up a stratigraphy of a volcano. Because on the volcano, it is difficult. So you have to go to the sea near the volcano.
Jyoti, I want clarification. Yeah, so you have a major event, in 23, late Pleistocene, I think, around 20,000 years, and there is a gap for 61,000 years. There is no eruption. What I read in the literature, major eruption in the day during the quarterly period happened almost 50% happened around 20,000 kilo years. Is it because of this major event during that 20,000 years approximately?
Say that I cannot say these things. There may have been a 20,000 year event for many volcanoes.
Yeah, 50%, literature says 50% of the volcanic eruption occurs during that period.
Okay. Well, I am not sure whether this volcano was active then or not.
Yeah, because there is a gap.
Volcano could have been active. It all means the volcano has been active since then. From at least 71 kilo years, it is active. Correct. Only in between, it was dormant for some time. Then it became more active. But I won't correlate this with 20 kilo year. Why should there be activity at 20 kilo year? I don't know.
No, 50% of the volcanic eruption has taken during that period.
In the quaternary.
That's what the literature says. Yes.
Yeah, possible. There may not be any. What is the cause of this activity? Because mantle doesn't respond to any surface processes that easily.
Okay.
So it doesn't really, any volcanic activity doesn't have a cycle as such. Because melting in mantle depends on many things, okay, as I told you. So this activity is directly dependent on how much melt is available to get
right.
it.
Okay.
So that can only happen if you have large scale melting in the mantle. And may have nothing to do with surface processes. We are talking about 60-70 kilometer down in the mantle. Even if it is there, maybe I don't know you, but maybe it is there. We have to figure it out.
Okay, thank you.
So this is the surface activity, but we tried to know when did this volcano actually come to the surface. So that means you have to actually date the surface rocks on the volcano. So that's what we tried. So we took the bottommost rock available for us, which are subaerial. So there are some rocks and we dated by argon. So that is 1.6 million years. So this all along the coast or the bottommost surface lava flow is 1.6. This is what we found. Not only that, one interesting thing we found, there are lavas which also contain a lot of xenocrysts, big crystals which are caught up by the magma from the crust. So when the eruption takes place, it catches some big crystals of older rocks, which could be the crustal rock, that the crust on which it is occurring. And these minerals, huge minerals are there. In fact, I'll show you much bigger, so you can see this. There are plagioclases, so they can be dated. So they are not part of this lava. So they are caught up in them. So when we dated, we found them to be 106 million year old. So that's the beauty. So the lava itself is 1.6 million year. The crystal, which is caught up by the magma, is 106 million year, which means this is a crustal rock. So this plagioclase belongs to a crust on which this volcano is sitting. So the crust of this place is 106 million year. Of course, the error is large here, which is very similar to the crust we see in Andaman main islands. That means from Andaman islands all the way to Barren Island, that is 70 kilometers or so, the crust could be of similar in composition on which the island is occurring or the volcano is occurring. This is what we published. Anyway, just briefly, this is some other people's work, tried to figure out where is the magma chamber, because the mantle melt doesn't erupt directly. So it comes and gets stored in a magma chamber. And then it has enough pressure built up, then it erupts. So in recently, there are only two papers in this regard. One was by 98 in Banerjee et al. Using magnetotellurics method. So they thought the magma chamber is located 17 to 27 kilometers below the surface. So that's quite deep. And recently, only one person from Space Applications Center in Ahmedabad, using INSAR method, they have found a shallow magma chamber, which is 580 meters. So both could be correct. We may have main magma chamber, which is located in the lithosphere, where most of the magma gets stored, and they come and get stored close to the surface and then get erupted. So that is, this is called secondary magma chamber. So anyway, so there is these are the indirect ways of trying to determine the magma chamber. Maybe there are better methods which we are trying to think whether we can use some muon tomography or so to figure out the location of the magma chamber where magma sits for a long time. Okay, so traditional geological things, when you take a rock, you study its mineralogy, petrology. So these are typical basaltic composition, cooled rapidly. We have observed compositional variation. The older rocks on the volcano are more variable in composition than the newer ones. And of course, we classify them. As I showed you, Narcondom were andesites. These are mostly basalts. So these are more primitive in nature. They are less contaminated by slab. This is what appears. And they have limited fractional crystallization. So, of course, we do a lot of geochemistry. I don't want to bore with you a lot of these things. So, and of course, trace elements and major elements. So, trace element pattern is typical of arc magmas. Arc magmas show this niobium, tantalum depletion, and a lot of features which are typical of subduction zone. What is most important is the following. There are a lot of things here. So how does this melting happens? As I told you in the beginning, here the slab, the subducting plate basically provides these fluids which changes the temperature of melting of the mantle here. And of course, a lot of material is also given to them or the mantle. So you have a mixture which is atypical of the mantle. So then you have modified the mantle, melting takes place, so the volcano, whatever is erupting, will have a mixed composition. So from there, you will know how the composition of the mantle has changed. Anyway, there are two different types of model. One is simple fluid melt getting contributed to cause this melting here. Another is sediment contribution. The sediment can get out and contribute to water as well as other elements into the mantle, and that will cause melting and contamination of the melt, which will ultimately get this eruption. So which one is true for barren? So we try to figure out. There are many ways to do this because you don't have access to it, but you can study it here while it is subducting. So this is a recent paper we have submitted in chemical geology. It is on the revised version is submitted. So we have found interesting things. In Barren Island, you will see, on the Andaman Islands, which are an accretionary prism, you see these kind of mud volcanoes. Petroleum geologists should know what are these. When you have a lot of sediments deposited, this organic matter and dehydration of clays will cause water and you can see this oil stuff to get erupted. And they are cold volcanoes. They are not really volcanoes. They are, it's a misnomer. But they are mostly mud diapirs, basically. So they erupt water, ooze water, mud. Mud means mostly clay minerals. And a lot of hydrocarbon gases. You see continuous eruption of methane. So where from they come? So this is what we have actually concluded. We studied these mud volcanoes geochemically, studied their gases. We have two papers, actually. So we figured out that actually this material which is subducting, it simply doesn't go that easily. It's not that easy to subduct everything into the mantle. So they get accumulated below this accretionary prism. So they are called melanges. So from there, they are unconsolidated sediment, but at very high pressure. So they release this water and mud, mud means clay minerals, etc., which come out through these fractures and faults of the accretionary prism and erupt as what is known as mud volcanoes. So why should I be interested in that? Since I don't have access to the material which is subducting, here is a channel through which the subducting material is getting sampled. So people do coring usually to know that. So I don't have to do coring. Nature has given me a channel. So here we studied this and tried to fix this end member. That means some of it is subducting, so we can sample it here. Because here it will be different in composition than it is here. Here it is a mixture of the ocean crust, the continental material, and of course there will be some material from the accretionary prism mixed together. And that is what is probably going down into the mantle and causing the volcanic activity. So anyway, so using various isotope techniques, we try to characterize this mud. And the same composition is used as an end member to understand. So these are isotopic composition of barren island lavas. If it were only pristine mantle, this would have been here, but they are here. So there is some contribution from the slab or the subducting material. So you want to quantify this. So this is a simple mixing models we do. And we try to figure out this here. In this case, it is 10 to 20% of the slab material have contaminated the mantle in order to give rise to these lavas. Or chemically, you can say 10 to 20% have been contributed to the Andaman mantle for generation of barren island lavas. And of course, we do compare globally, and particularly this is a part of the chain of Andaman, Indonesian volcanic front, which is also known as Banda Sunda subduction zone. So barren islands are very pristine in the sense they have very small contribution from the subducting slab. So it appears initially we thought maybe this mantle is very new, but if you look at the crust, which we dated is 106 million year. So even though it is 106 million year lithosphere, the rocks are quite pristine. The mantle is, because this composition of the rocks are directly representing the mantle source. The source is pristine. If it were not contaminated, it would have been here in the mid-Oceanic ridge. It is here. So which means, even though it is old, it has not been contaminated, or there is some other process, because it is unlikely that for 100 million years, things have not been contaminated. So same is the story for lead isotopes. What we envisage is the following. So I'll quickly show that. So this is what we are still writing. I'm just telling what we have interpreted. It appears that the back arc basin, this is the back arc, which is a mid-oceanic ridge, which is opening. So this is very young. This is what we plan to study. This is what we have requested a cruise from this year, that whether we can sample. There is one work though, but it is not exhaustive. So we have to sample the rocks from here. So these rocks represent the mid-oceanic ridges. Barren Island is here. From our geochemical or isotopic study, it appears as if this is contributing something to the Barren Island lavas. Otherwise, isotopically, it should have come to this Indonesian chain further down. So this is our suspicion, but we have to prove it. So unless we know the composition here, which is this mid-oceanic ridge lavas, we'll never know whether such a model is valid or not. So we know the composition here. We want to know this. We have already known what is going in. So then we have three components to play with and figure out what is the contribution. So I'd like to conclude. I've taken 10 more minutes. So what we have figured out over last 10 years or so is that the Narkondam volcano or Narkondam island is older than 3.5 million, at least 3.5 million year old, or it's older than that. And it probably became extinct around 0.55 million year or 550,000 years ago. Narkondam is a highly evolved arc volcano, having significant contribution from subducting material. Barren Island, the only active volcano in India, is 1.6 million year old, or older than 1.6, because 1.6 is the base of the volcano, which is subaerial, but we have 2.3 kilometers below the sea, which are not been dated. And then it had all these major eruptions, which we have found. And the crust beneath the Barren Island is 106 million year old. This I didn't touch this one. This is a geochemical modeling. You can know the depth of melting, which I didn't show. But from there, we have concluded that the depth of origin of the melts are around 70 kilometers or more. And altered oceanic crust is the major recycling agent that influences the mantle geochemistry. So there where I showed you the mud initially we thought it is just sediments, which are continental sediments, Bay of Bengal sediments, which are subducting, that is what is sampled. But geochemically, what we have found that actually they are part of the oceanic crust. Most of it, 70% or more, is the oceanic crust. Only 20 to 30% is the continental sediments. So that is an interesting finding. So this is, that means that this altered oceanic crust is actually what is being transported back into the mantle, not much sediment, at least in the Andaman subduction zone. So thank you. So this was our team. Of course, there is a bigger team. These are the main PIs of our project. This was a DST project, and then we had additional funding from DOS. So that's Rajnish Bhutani from Pondicherry. That's Hetu Seth. And that's Balakrishnan from Pondicherry University. That was 10 years ago. And these are my students, Alok Niraj and Eddie Sukla, though didn't work on it, but he did go. Yadava did carbon-14 dating. And Smita is also another student, but he worked in Pondicherry. So that's my team. And thank you very much. So if you have any questions.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
As you say, you showed the TAS variation diagram for Barren Island, and you said there is limited fraction crystallization there. Most of the samples were basalts to basaltic andesites, and you see some in the andesite, touching the andesite.
Yes. Yeah.
Is it because limitation in sampling, or there you may find more towards andesite also in Barren Island?
Okay. So what I didn't show you here, we have taken data from many sources. So we have not everything here. The only samples which show fractional train is the pre-caldera. So here, pre-caldera means the rocks which make up the caldera are pre-caldera, right?
Okay.
So those rocks which have been sampled by from many places, including GSI samples, they have actually gone on many places. So they only show this variation. Others, post-caldera and modern. So they are easily accessible. So those do not show anything. So it's not that we have a sampling limitation. It is just that there is not much variation recent times. I don't think there is much lava there, because most of the lava flows you can trace easily. It goes around, you can trace a particular lava flow. So, yeah, and also we have seen in the eruption which are deposited in the sea, that also are plotted. So, from there also we see there is a limited variation, because they also represent magmatic activity, right?
Okay.
Sir, I have one question here.
Yes, please.
Sir, in this, I have read some papers on this Barren Island, and I came to know that near to Barren Island, they have done two magnetic profile survey, and they found that across the Barren Land, they found very low magnetic field. And when they move a few degree ahead, then magnetic field was going down. So, if we can do a high-resolution gravity and magnetic survey there in that region, because I can see that at least around the island, we can collect high-resolution data. Then we may do some three-dimensional gravity density modeling, through that we can find that where is that magma chamber located below that.
See, the idea is not that nobody thought about it. The issue is logistics.
Yes.
This place, as I told you, we have to rely on Coast Guard and Navy. They give you only 2 days, 3 days, like that.
Yes.
And you cannot stay here also, because this is not a place to live.
Okay.
I mean, you don't have fresh water, you cannot camp, and it's very difficult. So you have to stay on the ship.
Okay.
So they cannot, because they have their job. It is only they provide a service to us. So they give maximum. I have taken 3 days. Even Gehlot tried longer time. They did not allow. So unless if you go on a specific particular project which allows you to hire a boat for yourself, yes, then it is possible.
Okay.
But we have to think. I mean, we can try, but so logistic is an issue. That's why not many people have worked really.
Okay, sir.
Jyoti, just I would like to add one point here.
Yes, please.
There was recently there was a discussion about 2 years back as part of the Deep Ocean program, Deep Ocean Mission program of MOES. They would like to study the subduction arc in Andaman. I think there is a major program is built in there. Probably as part of that, I think you can tie over what our Dubey, Prakash Dubey has said about that.
Are you talking about IODP?
Not IODP. I think there was a discussion as part of the Deep Ocean Mission program of MOES. I think there is a one program built in exclusively for Andaman subduction area.
And who are the PIs or authors?
No. I think that was a project, you know, program formulation stage. I think they would like to study the Andaman subduction arc, particularly that seismology group, they were planning about it in that.
Okay.
Probably that is still, as the Deep Ocean Motion Program, there is a one module there of Andaman Nicobar study program.
Okay, so I'll discuss with them.
Yes.
Find out.
Yeah, you can have the program in that.
Actually, I know, if you know Dr. Vinit Gulat.
Yes, Vinit Gulat, yes.
He was director of NCS for some time.
Yeah, right.
But he moved back. So he is working currently, but he works mostly on the main island because all earthquakes are here. But on Barren Island, he had put GPS to see the crustal movement. But twice he put the GPS and they were stolen. So I have seen his GPS once. And they are expensive, no? So,
right.
So, yeah, I mean, we will definitely try to. If you have a nice.
Anybody said about the.
Yes. Who is it?
Jyoti, any kind of the geomorphologic evolution of the islands?
No, sir. Yeah, nobody.
Because the island is almost. Pardon?
Your audio is not very clear. It goes up. Say it again, please.
That's because of that. Okay, so what they asked is that almost it appears similar size, both Barren as well as Andaman. Hello?
No, I mean I didn't get it. Still, you went blank in between.
Hello?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Oh, I see.
Why is it breaking?
So the islands and the size of the islands appears almost similar.
That which island are similar?
I'm sorry. Both Barren as well as Narconda.
Well, not really.
In terms of the shape and size.
No. Actually, in the first figure itself, I had. If you look here, it is more. Narconda is more elliptical and it is much larger.
Longer, right?
The island is quite
that's
long.
That's why it is hardly, the length is 3.2 kilometers approximately, both islands. Only the width is little less in the case of Narconda.
Yes.
Yeah, and the distance between these two are a little more than 130 kilometers.
Correct.
Yeah, so, but as you told, did anybody study about the geomorphic evolution of
No, sir. That's what I'm saying, nobody. Say, for example, Barren definitely has a lot of faults that is visible. But we really don't know. Nobody. In fact, I'll tell you, this is the first reasonable map we have prepared. In BSI has been working for so long. but the maps, they didn't have all the lava flows mapped. It is not here. I have published it, where we have actually tried to map the lava flows and make some reasonable geomorphological map. Otherwise, none exist. So, yeah, if you are interested, I will take you there.
The youngsters should take. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir. If we have... Nobody wants to go there? So, Srilesh?
Yes, sir.
Can we close then?
Yes, sir. If nobody have any more queries to...
If they have questions, they can write to me. I mean, people are shy here, looks like.
Yeah.
In other places, they will tear me apart.
So we will close this. Today we have about 80 plus people participating in the talk, which is a good sign. In the coming weeks, we will have talks from researchers and scientists. Your colleagues and friends will be presenting their research activities. So I also request
who is the next speaker?
I will put up the schedule on Monday, sir. We have scheduled 4 talks for this month. So Monday, I will put up the schedule.
Okay. So thank you, everybody, for listening. And hope this forum lives long. Thank you and have a good day. Good night.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks. Bye.
Thank you.